There are a lot of screenplay and narrative conventions that people often mistake for tropes. And in its contemporary sense, a trope refers to an overused narrative device or characterization or plot device, and we all just kind of sling the word around when we talk about media. For example, some tropes we know are things like the man-child gets his highly competent female co-star as a reward, or a superhero fights a different colored version of himself at the end of the story, or the superhero gets the highly competent female co-star as a reward, or the superhero only needed to believe in themselves the whole time, and on and on. If you want a comprehensive and toneless list, just spend a day paging through TV tropes. My point ultimately is that a lot of things people call tropes are really genre conventions and genre requirements. For example, in every James Bond film, there's often a moment where James Bond is tied up with a gun to his head, where the bad guy explains his bad guy motivation and plans. This is the hero at the mercy of the villain scene, and appears in basically every thriller. Which isn't to say this moment can't be done in surprising ways. In Silence of the Lambs, Clarice Starling is at the mercy of Buffalo Bill in this darkened room. It fulfills the hero at the mercy of the villain convention because Buffalo Bill has night vision goggles, but it's not repetitive or uninteresting. Equally, in Silence of the Lambs, the speech in praise of the villain, Buffalo Bill, is delivered by Hannibal as both a threat and information for Clarice, once again delivering a required beat of the genre in a surprising way. So I think when people criticize a story for using a trope, really what they mean is A, the trope is outdated and problematic, or B, it doesn't do anything new with the convention. Which brings me to my unnecessarily long explanation of why I love Spider-Man Homecoming, even though I find most of Marvel films a bit dull. I was originally going to make this video about Guardians 2 and why it's a great sequel, but the ending makes me cry too much, so we're talking about Spider-Man because I didn't want to cry today, and I definitely didn't cry rewatching Spider-Man either. Definitely didn't cry. Spider-Man Homecoming is a maturation plot. This basically means it's a coming-of-age story where its protagonist, Peter, goes from rudderless to being tested as an adult. Maturation plots are also known as Bildungsroman, a word in German which here means educational novel. Spider-Man Homecoming is also a thriller, starting with safety and external stakes, and as the narrative progresses, it ends with damnation and personal stakes for the protagonist, as well as the perils of mortality. And the internal and external plot of Homecoming is basically the same as Silence of the Lambs, except instead of the FBI, Peter must deal with the institution of school and the Avengers. So before we get started, what's the story of Homecoming and what are the required scenes and beats? Then we'll look at how Spider-Man does these in an interesting, surprising way. The film opens with the villain getting set up, so we'll keep it. It plants two of the Chekhov's guns of Adrian Toomes being Liz's dad and Tony being partly responsible for Toomes' turn to crime, and it also helps us understand a bit of the basic motivation for Toomes, as well as filling in new viewers some details about the Avengers and the New York incident. But the story really starts with Peter. Nerdy Peter Parker comes back from being a kid soldier to his regular life, unable to tell anyone about the events of Civil War. He struggles with being a regular kid while balancing his desire to be Spider-Man, and as things progress, Peter's attempts at stopping the Vulture only make things worse, eventually culminating in Tony Stark taking away Peter's suit. The film's final conflict involves Peter's Spider-Man and personal life colliding as he goes to prom, discovering that Toomes, the villain he wants to defeat, is also Liz's mother. With the help of Ned and the realization that doing the right thing is more important than being an Avenger, Peter pursues Toomes despite knowing he might be in real danger. He's challenged by either doing nothing and accepting damnation or stopping Toomes, putting his own life and the life of others on the line at the same time. And at the end of the day, Peter tries to save Toomes and learns the lesson that no one can make you an adult or an Avenger, it's your actions that define you. Before we get to the analysis, this is just a quick list of things I like about this film. Aunt May is a great parent, and that makes me really happy. Ned is a believable friend, and he never feels like a gimmicky sidekick. The kids behave mostly like kids. Even Flash is a bully who is a massive tool, and as an adult, you can see how they've portrayed these children incredibly well. The kids are also mostly kid-age, not 35-year-old men pretending to be in high school. So, that being said, I want to scope in on two scenes to look at how Homecoming takes genre conventions and does something different with them. The hero at the mercy of the villain is the moment we discussed earlier in James Bond films when the antagonist has the upper hand. This is often when they reveal their true plot or scheme. Some examples of lazy versions of this is basically the ending of every Harry Potter book, where Voldemort has Harry against the ropes and he's saved by love or courage. Pretty much the only book that doesn't do this is the third one, and it's one of the reasons that it's one of the best books. There's nothing wrong with JK's approach here, but there's nothing awe-inspiring about her solutions to these conventions either. In Homecoming, however, we're treated to a surprising, lengthy, tense sequence that starts with Peter arriving at Liz's house.
He must be Peter.
Yeah.
I'm Liz's dad. Put her there. Hell of a grip. Come on in here. Come on.
He opens the door to discover Toombs is there. The audience's initial fear is that Toombs has done something to Liz, and this washes away into a sort of anxious relief when Peter realizes Toombs is Liz's father. Toombs then drives them to the prom in a slow, uncomfortable car ride. Toombs slowly unravels Peter's identity as Spider-Man while Peter is unable to escape, flee, or fight back, knowing Liz might be in danger. Rather than point a gun to Peter's head, Homecoming chooses instead to use Peter's character to keep him at the villain's mercy. It's surprising and interesting, forcing the audience to interrogate and understand Peter's motivation, rather than relying on external forces like a gun or tying Peter to a chair, for instance. It's also got the added bonus of the twist of Toombs being Liz's father and it making total sense in the story, so that kind of keeps you on your toes as well as you go through this sequence. Toombs does point a gun at Peter toward the end, but it feels less like a direct threat to Peter and more like a warning that Toombs is going to kill everyone that Peter loves. This sequence makes me endlessly uncomfortable, particularly as it lifts experience from high school and growing up, which in this case is someone's scary dad, and then dresses it with the superhero setting, something that the Spider-Man comics do incredibly well. It's one of the reasons that a lot of the positive feedback on this film was about how well it portrayed Spider-Man as a character. It didn't just understand what makes the character interesting, it understands what makes the stories about him interesting.
Hey! Surprised?
Oh, hey, Pete.
The speech in praise of the villain is a requirement of the thriller genre that can take many forms. Its role in the story is to teach the audience about the motivations of the villain, and in a great story, helps the audience empathize with the villain or makes us so sickened by them that we want them taken down. As Steve Pressfield points out, the thing about a great villain speech is that it shouldn't be villainous, passionate, yes, and keen, but it must also make perfect sense. In our earlier example, Silence of the Lambs has the speech in praise of the villain, delivered by the FBI investigators and then Hannibal himself. Hannibal delivers this speech sort of throughout the whole movie with this dripping excitement and passion, but it never feels evil. It feels real and it feels like he believes it. Really, what Pressfield is trying to say is that a villain needs pathos. They need to believe their own motivation. In other words, the best villains are the heroes of their own story. In Spider-Man's case, Toombs and his crew are screwed over by damage control after laying down a lot of money for a job, so when they turn to crime to support their family, you can understand this motivation on its most basic level. But the film takes a unique approach to having Toombs explain this to Spider-Man, because while we can identify Toombs' motivation, one of the big tricks to having a villain that stays in your mind is having the audience understand and relate to their motivation. Because when a villain makes sense and is convincing, it transforms them from being a villain or a bad guy to a complex, unforgettable opponent to be overcome. For example, Voldemort is a bad antagonist because he never really makes a point. He's just evil throughout the series and wants to murder our heroes. There's very few moments in the story where we're offered the opportunity to really identify with Tom Riddle. He's just racist and doesn't make a lot of sense. Sure, we get some flashbacks, but it never really feels like we can understand why he does what he does, and I'm never convinced by Voldemort that he believes he's doing the right thing. Which brings us back to the speech in praise of the villain, and the way that Spider-Man wraps it in another trope, the man in the room.
You're young. You don't understand how the world works.
Yeah, but I understand that selling weapons to criminals is wrong.
How do you think your buddy Stark paid for that tower? Or any of his little toys?
Those people, Pete, those people up there, the rich and the powerful, they do whatever they want. Guys like us? You and me? They don't care about us. We build their roads and we fight all their wars and everything. They don't care about us. We have to pick up after them. We have to eat their table scraps.
The man in the room trope is less common in stories because now writers have grown more and more creative with their solutions to the villain speech, but there's something morbidly satisfying about the man in the room trope. This scene is often at the end of a labyrinth plot or detective story. It's the moment where the protagonist bursts in the door and comes face to face with the villain, and they're in a room. Often, if possible, the room should be locked, or there should be a reason why neither want to leave. Sometimes they just have guns pointed at each other. The protagonist and antagonist are on relatively equal footing, and they talk. They try to convince each other of their own worldviews, and they trade perspectives. This is often followed by a big punch-up or gunfight after the two parties realize they'll never be on the same page. Except, crucially, the audience is able to see that both sides have a point and they believe their own perspective. We're able to empathize with the villain's perspective, or at the very least, we get to see why they think they're correct. Homecoming does this with a lot of eloquence. Peter confronts Toomes at the 11th hour. Toomes explains why he's doing what he's doing. He even tells Peter that Peter doesn't understand the world yet. It's a bit melodramatic, but it tells the audience that Toomes is attempting to manipulate Peter. In this case, the goal is to distract Peter long enough to get the wingsuit airborne. Weirdly, the same trick that Green Goblin plays in Sam Raimi's first Spider-Man film. Though it works far better in Homecoming because this scene occurs in the middle of the third act, not as a climax to the story. Toomes tells Peter why he's wrong and then literally drops a building on him. This leaves Peter helpless. Tony Stark isn't there to save him, he has no backup, no one is coming. All he has is the idea of the hero he thinks Spider-Man should be. Because that's ultimately what Spider-Man is, a teenager's interpretation of Iron Man and Captain America and real, proper heroes. Peter Parker is not a superhero, he's just a kid trying to do the right thing, and it's in this moment he claims his maturity. Peter Parker can't lift a building. He's just a nerdy kid who struggles to talk to girls. But Spider-Man can do anything. Spider-Man is the hero Peter wishes he could be, and he's the hero we all wish we could be when we're kids. Spider-Man is confident, powerful, and important, but as Peter realizes in this moment, he can't be all of those things if he's doing them for the wrong reasons. So Peter calls on the one person he can always rely on. He asks Spider-Man for help.
If you're nothing without this suit, then you shouldn't have it.
Come on, Peter. Come on, Spider-Man. Come on, Spider-Man. Come on, Spider-Man! Oh, come on, Spider-Man!
First of all, before we get into this section, this will not be a universal experience. I did my analysis and research and finished the video, and then I came back and rewatched the film and re-recorded this. The script that you just heard has been in my Dropbox for a few months since I first watched the film, but I had a few beers on Easter afternoon and gave it a rewatch as part of my podcast. And something happened, which is why I've added this bit to the script. At the end of the second act, Peter struggles to save everyone on the Staten Island ferry. He interrupts an arms deal hoping to catch the Vulture, but accidentally ruins an FBI ambush of the illegal arms deal. Tony Stark swoops in to save the day and saves the lives of those on the ferry. Peter and Tony have a confrontation where Tony reveals he's believed Peter the whole time, but never said anything, ultimately leading Peter to the mistakes he made. Neither hero is right here. Tony didn't communicate with Peter at all about any of his plans, and Peter didn't trust Tony, feeling neglected and ignored by his hero and mentor. Tony steps up as a father figure and tells Peter to give back the suit, effectively revoking Peter's potential as an Avenger, and then Peter goes home. He goes inside, and Aunt May is distraught with worry about where Peter's been, upset and concerned by his latest truancy, and just generally worried in the way that parents are when they feel helpless.
You can't do that. Then this Pharaoh thing happens. I've called 5 police stations. 5. I called 5 of your friends. I called Ned's mother.
May, I'm okay. Honestly, just relax. I'm fine.
And it's here, as we see Peter start to cry, that I also started to cry.
You left the hotel room in Washington. I know you sneak out of this house every night. That's not fine.
Peter, you have to tell me what's going on.
If you're nothing without this suit, then you shouldn't have it, okay?
Lost a Stark internship.
What?
Yeah.
What happened?
I just thought I could work really hard and he would, you know, but screwed it up.
Because I remember this exact feeling as a teenager. Sure, I was never a superhero, but I think we all know this moment. I can vividly recall trying my hardest and failing, messing things up, worrying my parents sick, and generally disappointing people, a lot like Tony, only to come home and realize that the people that I disappointed just wanted the best for me in the first place. It seems silly to get emotional in a superhero film, but for this reason, I think Guardians 2 and Spider-Man have a lot in common. Both examine parenthood and maturity, it's just one is more direct and immediate. Because Tony is a distant father figure who actually believed Peter, it makes Spider-Man's failure even more upsetting. If Tony had saved the day and Peter was right to be mad, this would be a safe, okay end to the second act. And it would kind of validate Tony's weird, distant father behavior. Instead, Tony was genuinely in Peter's corner the whole time, but due to being distant and relatively new to being a father figure, Tony doesn't communicate this until it's too late. The impetus for Peter going off to the Vulture is that he didn't trust Happy and Tony to get the job done, and ultimately it's this lack of trust that caused the ferry accident and allowed the Vulture to get away. It's not that he wasn't a good enough superhero, it's that he didn't live up to his mentor's expectations. This is a moment I wasn't expecting in a Marvel film. And it landed for me because I've been where Peter is emotionally and psychologically. I'm bad with authority figures and struggle for validation, so even if this is a nothing scene for everyone else, it'll stay with me for a really long time. I can't say if Homecoming has this impact on everyone, and I suspect it's likely superhero fluff for a lot of viewers, which is totally okay. I wanted to share my experiences with the film because the way we consume media has a lot to do with where we are emotionally when we consume it. When I saw Homecoming in the cinema, I felt nothing, but now my life is different and I connect with different things. And I was engaged emotionally with these characters and these concepts. Which is to say, it's okay to change your mind about films after you've seen them, and it's okay if a film made you experience something no one else did. Media is hugely subjective in this way. So love what you love and let everyone else do the same thing. Which ultimately is to say, with its well-executed villain and brilliant High School Musical style interpretation of a thriller, Homecoming isn't the greatest superhero film of all time, but maybe, finally, a film with Peter Parker finally made me feel something.